Then first we must all exhaust ourselves pushing. If we collided, there was, of course, a row. If, as had happened that day, it was simply that while we coasted along, the machinery ceased to churn and rattle, then my father tried his hand as a mechanic. That was the worst contingency of all. At least it was the worst one connected with motoring. I'd learnt by experience that neither rain nor snow made much difference, and certainly not fog. But that afternoon, it was hotter than any day I could remember. I realised later it was the famous long summer of 1921, when the water at the bottom of cottage wells turned salt, and when eels were found baked and edible in their mud. But to know this at the time, I should have had to read the papers. And though through my mother's devotion, I had the trick of reading before my third birthday, I mostly left the practice to my younger brother Constantine. He was reading now from a pudgy volume, as thick as it was broad and resembling his own head in size and proportion. As always, he resumed his studies immediately the bumping of our almost springless car permitted, and even before the motion ceased. My mother sat in the front seat, inevitably correcting pupils' exercises. By teaching her native German in five schools at once, three of them distant, one of them fashionable, she surprisingly managed to maintain the four of us and our car. The front offside door of the car leaned dangerously open into the seething highway.
"I say!"
cried my father. The young man in the big yellow racer shook his head as he tore by. My father had addressed the least appropriate car on the road.
"I say!"
I cannot recall what the next car looked like, but it didn't stop. My father was facing the direction from which we'd come and sawing the air with his left hand like a very inexperienced policeman. Perhaps no one stopped because they thought him eccentric. Then a car going in the opposite direction came to a standstill behind my father's back. My father perceived nothing. A motorist sounded his horn. In those days, horns squealed, and I covered my ears with my hands. Between my hands and my head, my long, fair hair was like brittle flax in the sun. My father darted through the traffic. I think it was the Portsmouth Road. The man in the other car got out and came to us. I noticed his companion, much younger and in a cherry-coloured cloche, begin to deal with her nails. "Broken down?" asked the man. To me it seemed obvious, as the road was strewn with bits of the engine and oozing blobs of oil. Moreover, surely my father had explained.
"I can't quite locate the seat of the trouble," said my father.
The man took off one of his driving gauntlets, big and dirty. "Catch hold for a moment." My father caught hold. The man put his hand into the engine and made a casual movement. Something snapped loudly. "Done right in, if you ask me. I'm not sure she'll ever go again."
"Then I don't think I shall ask you,"
said my father affably. "Hot, isn't it?" My father began to mop his tall, corrugated brow and front-to-back ridges of grey hair.
"Want a tow?"
"Just to the nearest garage." My father always spoke the word in perfect French.
"Where to?"
"To the nearest car repair workshop, if it would not be troubling you too much."
"Can't help myself now, can I?"
From under the back seat in the other car, the owner got out a thick, frayed rope, black and greasy as the hands. The owner's friend simply said, "Pleased to meet you," and began to replace her scalpels and enamels in their cabinet. We jolted towards the town we had traversed an hour or two before, and were then untied outside a garage on the outskirts. "Surely it is closed for the holiday," said my mother. Hers is a voice I can always recall upon an instant. Guttural, of course, but beautiful, truly golden. "Expect he'll be back," said our benefactor, drawing in his rope like a fisherman. "Give him a bang." He kicked 3 times very loudly upon the dropped iron shutter, then without another word, he drove away. It was my birthday. I'd been promised the sea and I began to weep. Constantine, with a fretful little wriggle, closed further into himself and his book. But my mother leaned over the front seat of the car and opened her arms to me. I went to her and sobbed on the shoulder of her bright red dress. "Kleine Lena, verstecken schön in der Tinte." My father, who could pronounce 6 languages perfectly, but speak only one of them, never liked my mother to use her native tongue within the family. He rapped more loudly on the shutter. My mother knew his ways, but where our welfare was at stake, ignored them. "Edgar," said my mother, "let us give the children presents, especially my little Lena." My tears, though childish and less viscous than those shed in later life, had turned the scarlet shoulder of her dress to purple. She squinted, smiling sideways at the damage. My father was delighted to defer the decision about what next to do with the car, but as pillage as possible, my mother took with her the exercises and Constantine his fat little book. We straggled along the main road, torrid, raucous, adequate only for a gentler period of history. The grit and dust stung my face and arms and knees like granulated glass. My mother and I went first, she holding my hand. My father struggled to walk at her other side, but for most of the way the path was too narrow. Constantine mused along in the rear, abstracted as usual. Ultimately, we reached the high street. The very first shop had one of its windows stuffed with toys, the other being stacked with groceries and draperies and coal odds, all dingy. The name Popular Bazaar, in wooden relief as it glued on in building blocks, stretched across the whole front, not quite centre. It was not merely an out-of-fashion shop, but a shop that at best sold too much of what no one wanted. My father comprehended the contents of the toy department window with a single anxious glance and said, "Choose whatever you like, both of you. But look very carefully first and don't hurry." Then he turned away and began to hum a fragment of the Lady of the Rose. But Constantine spoke at once. "I choose those telegraph wires." They ranged beside a line of tin railway that stretched right across the window, long undusted and tending to buckle. There were 7 or 8 posts with 6 wires on each of the posts. Though I could not think why Constantine wanted them, and though in the event he did not get them, the appearance of them and of the rusty track beneath them is all that remains clear in my memory of that window. "I doubt whether they're for sale," said my father. "Look again, there's a good boy, no hurry." "They're all I want," said Constantine, and turned his back on the uninspired display. "Well, we'll see," said my father. "I'll make a special point of it with the man." He turned to me. "And what about you?" "Very few dolls, I'm afraid. I don't like dolls anymore." As a matter of fact, I'd never owned a proper doll, although I suffered from this fact only when competing with other girls, which meant very seldom, for our friends were few and occasional. The dolls in the window were fly-blown and detestable. "I think we could find a better shop from which to give Lena a birthday present," said my mother, in her correct, dignified English. "We must not be unjust," said my father, "when we have not even looked inside." The inferiority of the goods implied cheapness, which unfortunately always mattered, although as it happened, none of the articles seemed actually to be priced.
I do not like this shop, said my mother. It is a shop that has died. Her regal manner when she said such things was, I think, too Germanic for my father's Englishness. That, and the prospect of unexpected economy, perhaps led him to be firm. We have Constantine's present to consider as well as Lena's. Let us go in. By contrast with the blazing highway, the main impression of the interior was darkness. After a few moments, I also became aware of a smell. Everything in the shop smelt of that smell, and one felt always would do so. A mixed odour of any general store, but at once enhanced and passé. I can smell it now. We do not necessarily want to buy anything, said my father, but if we may, we should like to look around. Since the days of Mr. Selfridge, the proposition is supposed to be taken for granted, but at that time the message had yet to spread. The bazaar keeper seemed hardly to welcome it. He was younger than I expected. He wore an untidy grey suit and bedroom slippers. Look about you, children, said my father. Take your time. We can't buy presents every day. I noticed my mother still stood in the doorway. I want those wires, said Constantine. Make sure by looking at other things first. Constantine turned aside, bored, his book held behind his back. He began to scrape his feet. It was up to me to uphold my father's position. Rather timidly, I began to peer about, not going far from him. The bazaar keeper silently watched me with eyes colourless in the twilight. Those toy telegraph poles in your window, said my father after a pause, fraught for me with anxiety and responsibility. How much would you take for them? They're not for sale, said the bazaar keeper, and said no more. Then why do you display them in your window? They're a kind of decoration, I suppose. Did he not know, I wondered? Even if they're not normally for sale, perhaps he'll sell them to me, said my vagabond father, smiling like Rothschild. My son, you see, has taken a special fancy to them. Sorry, said the man in the shop. Are you the principal here? I am. Then surely, as a reasonable man, said my father, switching from superiority to ingratiation, then address the window. They're not for sale. This dialogue entered through the back of my head as diligently and unobtrudingly I conned the musty stock. At the back of the shop was a window curtained all over in grey lace. To judge by the weak light it offered, it gave on to the living quarters. Through this much filtered illumination glimmered the facade of an enormous doll's house. I wanted it at once. Dolls had never been central to my happiness, but this abode of theirs was the most grown-up thing in the shop. It had battlements and long straight walls and a variety of pointed windows. A Gothic revival house, or even a mansion. It was painted the colour of stone, a grey stone darker than the grey light, which flickered around it. There was a two-leaved front door with a small, classical portico. It was impossible to see the whole house at once, as it stood grimed and neglected on the corner of the wide trestle shelf. Very slowly, I walked along two of the sides, the other two being dark against the walls of the shop. From a first floor window on the side, not immediately visible as one approached, leaned a doll, droopy and unkempt. It was unlike any real house I'd seen, and as for dolls' houses, they were always after the style of the villa near Gerard's Cross belonging to my father's successful brother. My uncle's house, it looked much more like a toy than this austere structure before me. Wake up, said my mother's voice. She was standing just behind me. What about some light on the subject, inquired my father. A switch clicked. The house really was magnificent, obviously beyond all financial reach.
Looks like a model for Pentonville Jail, observed my father.
It's beautiful, I said. It's what I want.
It's the most depressing looking plaything I ever saw.
I want to pretend to live in it and give masked balls. My social history was eager but indiscriminate. How much is it? Asked my mother. The bazaar keeper stood resentfully in the background, sliding each hand between the thumb and fingers of the other. It's only second hand, he said. 10 grand more like. A lady brought it in and said she needed to get rid of it. I don't want to sell you something you don't want.
But suppose we do want it, said my father truculently. Is nothing in this shop for sale?
You can take it away for a quid, said the bazaar keeper. I'm glad we have the space.
There's someone looking out, said Constantine. He seemed to be assessing the house like a surveyor or valuer.
It's full of dolls, said the bazaar keeper. They're thrown in.
Sure you can transport it?
Not at the moment, said my father, but I'll send someone down. This I knew would be Moon the Seedman, who owned a large canvas-topped lorry and with whom my father used to fraternise on the putting green.
Are you quite sure? My mother asked me.
Will it take up too much room?
My mother shook her head. Indeed, our home, though out of date and out of the elbows, was considerably too large for us.
Then please.
Poor Constantine got nothing.
Mercifully, all our rooms had wide doors, so that Moon's driver, assisted by the youth out of his shop, lent specially for the purpose, could ease my birthday presents into its new nesting place without tilting it or inflicting a wound upon my mother's new and self-applied paint. I noticed that the doll at the first floor window had prudently withdrawn. For my house, my parents had allotted me the principal spare room, because in the centre of it stood a very large dinner table, once to be found in the servants' hall of my father's childhood home in Lincolnshire. On the big table, the driver and the shop boy set down my house.
Snug as a bug in a rug, said Moon's driver when the perilous walks at the sides of the house had been made straight and equal.
Snugger, said Moon's boy.
I waited for their boots, mailed with crescent slivers of steel, to reach the bottom of our creaking coconut matted stair. Then I tiptoed to the landing, looked and listened. The sun had gone in just before the lorry arrived, and down the passage the motes had ceased to dance. It was 3 o'clock. My mother was still at one of her schools. My father was at the rifle range. I heard the men shut the back door. The principal spare room had never before been occupied, so that the key was outside, and in a second I transferred it to the inside and shut and locked the door. As before in the shop, I walked slowly around my house, but this time round all four sides of it. Then, with the knuckles of my thin white forefinger, I tapped gently at the front door. It seemed not to have been secured because it opened both leaves of it as I touched it. I pried in, first with one eye, then with the other. The lights from various of the pointed windows blotched the walls and floor of the miniature entrance hall. None of the dolls were visible. It was not one of those dolls' houses of commerce from which sides can be lifted in their entirety. To learn about my house, it would be necessary, albeit impolite, to stare through the windows one by one. I decided first to take the ground floor. I started in a clockwise direction from the front portico. The front door was still open, but I couldn't see how to shut it from the outside. There was a room to the right of the hall, leading into two other rooms along the right side of the house, of which again one led into the other. All the rooms were decorated and furnished in a Mrs. Fitzherbertish style, with handsomely striped wallpapers, botanical carpets, and chairs with legs like sticks of brittle golden sweetmeat. There were a number of pictures. I knew just what they were. They were family portraits. I named the room next to the hall the occasional room, and the room beyond it, the morning room. The third room was very small. Striking out confidently, I named it the Canton Cabinet, although it contained neither porcelain nor fans. Then came the long drawing room, which stretched across the entire garden front of the house and contained the principal concourse of dolls. It had four pointed French windows, all made to open, though now sealed with dust and rust, above which were bulbous triangles of coloured glass in tiny snowflake panes. On the stout golden wallpaper were decent Swiss pastels of indeterminate subjects. There was a grand piano, very black, scrolly, and no doubt resounding. Four shapely chandeliers, a baronial fireplace with a mythical blazon above the mantel, and eight dolls, all of them female, dotted about on chairs and ottomans with their backs to me. I hardly dared to breathe as I regarded their woolly heads and noted the colours of their hair. Too black, too nondescript. One grey, one a discoloured silver beneath the dust, one blonde, and one a dyed-looking red. They wore woolen Victorian clothes of a period later, I should say, than that when the house was built. And certainly too warm for the present season. In varied colours, all of them dull. Happy people, I felt even then, would not wear these variants of rust, indigo, and greenwood. I crept onwards to the dining room. It occupied half its size of the side of the house and was dark and oppressive. Perhaps it might look inviting when the chandelier blazed and the table candles, each with a tiny purple shade, were lighted. There was no cloth on the table and no food or drink. Over the fireplace was a big portrait of a furious old man. His white hair was a spiky aureole around his distorted face, beetroot red with rage. The mouth was open. And even the heavy lips were drawn back to show the savage, strong teeth. He was brandishing a very thick walking stick, which seemed to leap from the picture and stun the beholder. I was frightened. Two rooms on the ground floor remained before I once more reached the front door. In the first of them, a lady was writing with her back to the light and therefore to me. She frightened me also, because her grey hair was disordered and of uneven length and descended in matted plaits, like snakes escaping from a basket, to the shoulders of her coarse grey dress. Of course, being a doll, she did not move, but the back of her head looked mad. Her presence prevented me from regarding at all closely the furnishings of the writing room. Back at the north front, as I resolved to call it, there was a cold-looking room with a carpetless stone floor and white walls upon which were mounted heads and horns of many animals. They were all the room contained, but they covered the walls from floor to ceiling. I felt sure that the ferocious old man in the dining room had killed all those creatures, and I hated him for it. But I knew what the room should be called. It would be the trophy room. Then I realised there was no kitchen. It could hardly be upstairs. I'd never heard of such a thing. But I looked. It wasn't there. All the rooms on the first floor were bedrooms. There were six of them, and they so resembled one another, all with dark, ochreous wallpaper and narrow brass bedsteads corroded with neglect, that I found it impracticable to distinguish them from each other than by numbers, at least for the present. Bedrooms 2, 3, and 6 contained two beds each. I recall that at least 9 people lived in the house. One room, the dark walls, the dark floor, the bed linen, even the glass in the window were splashed, smeared, and further darkened with ink. It seemed apparent who slept there. I sat on an orange box and looked. My house needed painting and dusting and scrubbing and polishing and renewing. But on the whole, I was relieved that things were not worse. We simply lacked the money to regild my long drawing room in proper gold leaf. But I would bring to life the 9 dolls, now drooping with boredom and neglect. Then I recalled something. What had become of the doll who'd been sagging out of the window? I thought she must have been jolted out and felt myself a murderess. But none of the windows was open. The sash might easily have descended with the shaking, but more probably the poor doll lay inside on the floor of her room. I again went round from room to room, this time on tiptoe, but it was impossible to see the areas of the floor just below the dark windows. It was not merely sunless outside, but heavily overcast. I unlocked the door of our principal's spare room and descended pensively to await my mother's return and tea. Wormwood Grange, my father called my house, with penological associations still on his mind. After he was run over, I realised for the first time there might be a reason for this and for his inability to find work worthy of him. My mother made the most careful inspection on my behalf, but had been unable to suggest any way of making an entry, or at least passing beyond the hall, to which the front door still lay open. There seemed no question of whole walls lifting off, or of the roof being removable, or even of a window being opened, including, mysteriously, on the first floor. "I don't think it's meant for children, Legion," said my mother, smiling her lovely smile. "We shall have to consult the Victoria and Albert Museum." "Of course it's not meant for children," I replied. "That's why I wanted it. I'm going to receive, like La Belle Opera." Next morning, after my mother had gone to work, my father came up and wrenched and prodded with his unskillful hands. "I'll get a chisel," he said. "We'll pry it open at each corner, and when we've got the fronts off, I'll go to Woolworths and buy some hinges and screws. I expect they'll have some." At that, I struck my father in the chest with my fist. He seized my wrists, and I screamed that he was not to lay a finger on my beautiful house, that he would be sure to spoil it, that force never got anyone anywhere. I knew my father. When he took an idea for using tools into his head, the only hope for one's property lay in a scene and in the implication of tears without end in the future if the idea were not dropped. While I was screaming and raving, Constantine appeared from the room below where he worked at his books. "Give us a chance, sis. How can I keep it all in my head about the 30 Years' War when you haven't learned to control your tantrums?" Although 2 years younger than I, Constantine should have known that I was past the age for screaming except for set purpose. "You wait until he tries to rebind all your books, you silly sneak," I yelled at him. My father released my wrists. "Wormwood Grange can keep," he said. "I'll think of something else to go to Woolworths for." He sauntered off. Constantine nodded gravely. "I understand. I understand what you mean. I'll go back to my work. Here, try this." He gave me a small chipped nail file. I spent most of the morning fiddling very cautiously with the imperfect jemmy and trying to make up my mind about the doll in the window. I failed to get into my house, and I refused to let my parents give me any effective aid. Perhaps by now, I did not really want to get in, although the dirt and disrepair and the apathy of the dolls who'd so badly needed plumping up and dispersing continued to cause me distress. Certainly, I spent as long trying to shut the front door as trying to open a window or find a concealed spring. In the end, I wedged the two halves of the front door with two halves of match, but I felt that the arrangement was makeshift and undignified. I refused everyone access to the principal spare room until something more appropriate could be evolved. My plans for routs and orgies had to be deferred. One could hardly riot amongst dust and cobwebs. Then I began to have dreams about my house and about its occupants. One of the oddest dreams was the first. It was 3 or 4 days after I entered into possession. During that time, it had remained cloudy and oppressive, so that my father took to leaving off his knitted waistcoat. And then suddenly it thundered. It was long, slow, distant, intermittent thunder, and continued all the evening until when it was quite dark, my bedtime and Constantine's could no longer be deferred. I slept almost immediately, although the thunder was rolling round my big, rather empty bedroom, round the floor, the four walls, across the floor, and under the ceiling, weighting the black air as with a smoky vapour. Occasionally, the lightning glinted pink and green. It was still the long, drawn-out preliminary to a storm, the tedious, imperfect dispersal of the accumulated energy of a summer. The rollings and rumblings entered my dreams, which flickered, changed, and were gone as soon as come, failed like the lightning to concentrate or strike home, were as difficult to profit by as the events of an average day. After exhausting hours of phantasmagoria, anticipating so many later nights in my life, I found myself in a black wood with huge, dense trees. I was following a path, but reeled from tree to tree, bruising and cutting myself on their hardness and roughness. There seemed no end to the wood or to the night, but suddenly, in the thick of both, I came upon my house. It stood solid, immense, hemmed in with a single light, little more, it seemed, than a nightlight burning in every upstairs window and illuminating 2 wooden wedges, jagged and swollen, which held tight the front doors. The vast trees dipped and swayed their elephantine boughs over the roof. The wind peeped and creaked through the black battlements. Then there was a blaze of whitest lightning, proclaiming the storm itself. In the second it endured, I saw my 2 wedges fly through the air and the double front doors burst open. For the 100th time, the scene changed. And now I was back in my room, though still asleep or half asleep, still dragged from vision to vision. Now the thunder was coming in immense, calculated bombardments, the lightning ceaseless and searing the face of the earth. From being a weariness, the storm had become an ecstasy. It seemed as if the whole world would be in dissolution before the thunder had spent its impersonal, unregarding strength. I do not know whether I was asleep or awake when the storm rippled into tranquility. I certainly did not feel that the air had cleared, but this may have been because, surprisingly, I heard a quick, soft step passing along the passage outside my room, a passage uncarpeted through our poverty. I well knew all the footsteps in the house, and this was none of them. Always one to meet trouble halfway, I dashed in my nightgown to open the door. I looked out. The dawn was seeping without effort or momentum through every cranny and showed, shadowy, the back of a retreating figure. The size of my mother, but with woolly red hair and long, rust-coloured dress. The padding feet seemed actually to start soft echoes amid all that naked woodwork. I had no need to consider who she was or whither she was bound. I burst into the purposeless tears I so despised. In the morning, and before deciding upon what to impart, I took Constantine with me to look at the house. I more than half expected big changes, but none was to be seen. The sections of matchstick were still in position, and the dolls as inactive and diminutive as ever, sitting with their backs to me on chairs and sofas in the long drawing room, their hair dusty possibly even moth-y. Constantine looked at me curiously, but I imparted nothing. Other dreams followed, though at considerable intervals. Many children have recurring nightmares of oppressive realism and terrifying content, and I realised from past experience that I must outgrow the habit or lose my house. My house, at least. It is true that my house now frightened me, but I felt that I must not be foolish and should strive to take a grown-up view of painted woodwork and nine understuffed dolls. Still, it was bad when I began to hear them in the darkness. Some tapping, some stumping, some creeping, and therefore not one, but many or all. And worse, when I began not to sleep for fear of the mad doll, as I was sure she was, doing something mad, although I refused to think what. I never dared again to look, but when something happened, which as I say was only at intervals, I lay taut and straining amongst forgotten sheets. Moreover, the steps themselves were never quite constant, certainly too inconstant to report to others, and I'm not sure that I should have heard anything significant if I had not once seen. But now I locked the door of our principal spare room from the outside and altogether ceased to visit my beautiful, impregnable mansion. I noticed that my mother made no comment, but one day my father complained loudly of my ingratitude in never playing with my handsome birthday present. I said I was occupied with my holiday task, Moby Dick. This was an approved answer, and even as it went, a true one, though I found the book pointless and horribly cruel. I told you the Grange was the wrong thing to buy, said my father. Morbid sort of object for a toy. None of us can learn except by experience, said my mother. My father said, not at all, and bristled. One day I returned to our dining room table littered with peculiarly uninteresting printed drawings. I could make nothing of them whatsoever, and they curled up themselves and then bit me. My father had, a week or two before, taken one of his infrequent jobs, night work of some kind, a long way off, to which he had now departed in our car. Obviously, these drawings were connected with Constantine, but he wasn't there. I went upstairs and saw that the principal's spare room door was open and Constantine was inside. Hello, Lena, Constantine said in his matter-of-fact way. We've been doing axonometric projection when I'm projecting your house. He was making one of his drawings on a sheet of thick white paper. It's for homework. It'll knock out all the others. They've got to do their real houses. I'll help, I said. Tell me what to do. It's a bore I can't get in to take the measurements, although we haven't got to. In fact, the clot told us not to. Just a general impression, he said. It's to give us the concept of axonometry. But golly, it would be simpler with feet and inches. Tell me, I said. Tell me what to do, and I'll do it. Thanks, he said, sharpening his pencil with a special instrument. But it's a one-man job, this. In the nature of the case. Later, I'll show you how to do it, and maybe you can do some other building if you like. I remained, looking at my house and fingering it, until Constantine made it even clearer that I was a distraction. I went away, changed my shoes, and put on the kettle against my mother's arrival and our high tea. When Constantine came down, my mother had called for him three times already, but that wasn't unusual. He said, I say, sis, here's a rum thing. My mother said, don't use slang, and don't call your sister sis. He said, as he always did when reproved by her, I'm sorry, mother. Then he thrust the drawing paper at me. Look, there's a bit missing. See what I mean? He was showing me with the stub of his emerald pencil, popped with tooth marks. Of course, I didn't see. I didn't understand a thing about it. After tea, said my mother. She gave to such familiar words not a maternal, but an imperial decisiveness. But mum, pleaded Constantine. Mother, said my mother. Constantine started dipping for sauerkraut. Silently, we ate ourselves into tranquility, or for me, into the appearance of it. Now, what is all this you are doing? Inquired my mother in the end. It resembles the Rosetta Stone. I'm taking an axonometric cast of Lena's birthday house. And so? But Constantine was not now going to expand immediately. He put in his mouth a finger of rye bread smeared with homemade cheese. Then he said quietly, I got down a rough idea of the house, but the rooms don't fit. At least they don't on the bottom floor. It's all right, I think, on the top floor. In fact, that's the rummest thing of all. Sorry, Mother. He had been speaking with his mouth full and now filled it fuller. What nonsense is this? To me, it seemed that my mother was glaring at him in a way most unlike her. It's not nonsense, Mother. Of course, I haven't measured the place because you can't. But I haven't done axonometry for nothing. There's a part of the bottom floor I can't get at. A secret room or something. Show me. Very well, Mother. Constantine put down his remnant of bread and cheese. He rose, looking a little pale. He took the drawing round the table to my mother. Not that thing. I can't understand it, and I don't believe you can understand it either. Only sometimes to my father did my mother speak like that. Show me the house. I rose too. You stay here, Lena. Put some more water in the kettle and boil it. But it's my house. I have a right to know. My mother's expression changed to one more familiar. Yes, Lena, you have a right. But please, not now. I ask you. I smiled at her and picked up the kettle. Come, Constantine. They were not long gone, for well before the kettle had begun even to grunt, my mother's beautiful voice was summoning me back. Constantine is quite right, she said, and it was wrong of me to doubt it. The house is built in a funny sort of way. But what does it matter? Constantine was not eating. I'm glad you're studying well and learning such useful things, said my mother. She wished the subject to be dropped, and we dropped it. Indeed, it was difficult to think what more could be said, but I waited for a moment in which I was alone with Constantine. My father's absence made this difficult, and it was completely dark before the moment came. And when, as was only to be expected, Constantine had nothing to add, I felt most unreasonably that he was joined with my mother in keeping something from me. But what happened, I pressed him. What happened when you were in the room with her? What do you think happened? Replied Constantine, wishing I thought that my mother would re-enter. Mother realised I was right. Nothing more. What does it matter anyway? That final query confirmed my doubts. Constantine, I said, is there anything I ought to do? Better hack the place open, he answered, almost irritably. But a most unexpected thing happened. When next day I returned from school, my house was gone. Constantine was sitting in his usual corner, this time absorbing Greek paradigms. I went straight to the principal's spare room. The vast deal table, less scrubbed than once, was bare. The place where my house had stood was very visible, as indeed, as if a palace had been swept off by a djinn. But I could see no other sign of its passing, no scratched woodwork, or marks of boots, or disjoined fragments. Constantine seemed genuinely astonished at the news, but I doubted him. You knew, I said. Of course I didn't know. Still, he understood what I was thinking. He said again, I didn't know. Unlike me on occasion, he always spoke the truth. I gathered myself together and blurted out, have they done it themselves? Inevitably, I was frightened, but in a way, almost relieved.
Who do you mean?
They. I was inviting ridicule, but Constantine was kind. He said, I know who you think has done it, but you mustn't let on. I know who I think has done it, but you mustn't let on. I think Mother's done it. I did not inquire uselessly into how much more he knew than I, but I said, but how? Constantine shrugged. It was a habit he had assimilated with so much else.
Mother left the house with us this morning and she isn't back yet.
She must have put Father up to it.
But there are no marks.
Father might have got help. There was a pause. Then Constantine said,
are you sorry?
In a way, I replied. Constantine, with precocious wisdom, left it at that. When my mother returned, she simply said that my father had already lost his new job, so that we'd had to sell things. She, too, was one I'd never known to lie. But now I began to perceive how relative and instrumental truth can be.
Let everybody breathe.